Thank you to RX Bar for supporting Don't Blame Me. RX Bar is a whole food protein bar with no BS. Get 25% off your first order at rxbar.com/blame and use the promo code BLAME. Again, that is rxbar.com/blame, promo code BLAME. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Don't Blame Me. Today, we have a super exciting guest. Beep, boop, beep, do-do-do-do-do. She gets a whole intro song because I love her and she's dancing along. Woo! It's Aislinn Paul, everybody.
Hello. Yeah, I hope you're not surprised by that.
No. You have a great podcast voice.
Thank you.
I don't know why. I hear you talk all the time, but for some reason, as
do
soon
I need
as...
to be closer to the mic?
Ooh.
Get nice and low.
Yeah, don't be shy.
Nice and deep.
That's
hello.
So good.
I think it's also just today. I think I just... I have
are
a
you Are you struggling with a cold as well?
I hope not.
You have a sore throat?
I woke up and it was a little bit scratchy, so I hope that's not where it's going.
You went to a party. That's what happens. You're shouting over loud music.
I went to a party and I was very sober. And
there you go. Mind over matter. She's not sick. She just went to a party.
It's true. It is. Oh, also, speaking of this man who is heckling Aislinn for going to a party.
Sorry.
Jack Barry.
Hi. Sorry, I am the talkative producer. Hi.
Hi. And you guys are listening to Don't Blame Me, which is my podcast.
The best advice podcast out there.
Aislinn was listening
endorsed
to this.
By Aislinn Paul.
It's true. She was listening to it on the way over. And it made me happy. And tell them what you, I'm like, tell them, I feel like I'm like, tell them what you told me. Where I'm like, no, say what you said. So I was like, say what you said, but how you listened to it, where you like pause or whatever.
Oh, I'd listen along to the questions and then I'd wonder, well, it was kind of to prep for this. I was like, I'm going to be so bad at this because I go to Meghan for my advice. So I was like, okay, how would I answer these questions? And then you guys are going through some tough shit out there.
Yeah.
Like, I'm impressed. My teenage years were very boring compared to you guys.
I know. I feel that way a lot of the time where I'm like, damn, I still can't get over the girl who fucked her boyfriend's twin and his brother.
That is straight out of Gossip Girl.
I was like, did you take this as a plot from a TV show? But I'm pretty sure that she DM'd me on Instagram and I can't find it now, but I think she called back and gave an update. Did she?
Forever we will ago? Have to dig that out of the archives.
I think she did.
I know. I'm dying.
I think they broke up.
Ooh. Well, we have like hundreds of calls.
Yes.
So it's not always the easiest, but I will get my crack team to dig that out for
your crack team.
My crack team. I have a crack team.
Crack team?
Yeah.
For all your crack needs?
Yes.
Jack Barry has.
No, my cracker jack team of like all stars.
Oh my God.
Who are working behind the scenes who you don't even see.
Are your fans called cracker jacks?
Yeah, this is getting weirder.
No, it's crack. No, it's like, you know, my crack team of experts. You never heard that expression?
No,
you never heard my crack team of experts before?
No, everyone here is shaking their head. They've never heard it.
You never heard my crack team of experts?
No, it sounds like you have a team of people who are experts in crack.
On crack. Oh, yeah, no.
I'm looking this up right now.
I literally, and then I thought you were like Jake Paulers, but like cracker jackers.
Oh my God, that's actually great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's like slightly racist, but like right.
The use of crack as a top notch or superior was first noted by Samuel Johnson in 1793, meaning to do anything with quickness or smartness. A crack team is one that functions in this way.
Okay, now Urban Dictionary, crack team.
Oh, a team that sells crack. Okay, I can see where the confusion came in.
I totally get that.
Anyway, explain your relationship. How do you guys know each other?
Oh, my God. Well, Aislinn and I met on Freakish Season 1.
Yes.
Actually, we met in the cat... We were...
Yeah, it was
chemistry reads, but we didn't read with each other.
No, we thought maybe we would, and then we didn't. But what I can say is that I was a little alarmed by Meghan when I first met her.
Fucking shit. Everyone says that.
Well, also, I arrived maybe 20
tall.
Minutes late
because
I'm late to everything. And then you had already made friends with all the other girls who were there. Like, it seemed like you guys had all known each other for years. And then you told me after that wasn't the case. But I was like, it was intimidating as fuck. Because I was just like, I don't know what I'm doing. And you seem like you know everyone. Even in the office, you were like running to other offices and saying hello. And I was like, who is this bitch?
I do.
And now we're friends.
Awesomeness TV is the only office where I can walk in and be like, I know everyone here. That's it. Just because they've known me since I was 18. But no, I talk when I'm nervous. So I'm like quick to be like, who wants to be my friend? Let's talk. Let's not be uncomfortable. Who wants to talk to me? Yeah. And then we did the show together and we got to hate each other on the show.
And season 2 just came out.
It did. Mm. And
only on Hulu,
and I'm
Hulu,
so excited.
Right?
I've seen a few episodes so far.
Do you
want
to give a spoiler of your season one experience?
Oh, what? That I died? Sorry, spoiler if you want to watch it. Yeah, you will only get the pleasure of watching me on your screen for the first season. I'm sorry.
But the good news is you're alive in real life.
Yes, in real life I am here. And I'm also here to tell you that second season is unbelievable. I've seen like the first half and I was so into it. For a show that I was on to now watch it, I'm so into it, way more into it than I thought I would be. It's intense.
You're
so good.
Way more into it than I thought you would be, too.
Yeah, I'm like a true fan now.
It was honestly the most entertaining part of the screening was watching Aislinn watch us all, because it was like half of a mix of like a proud parent who's like, oh my God, look at all my friends.
Baby.
I'm so happy for all of them. And then also for being like not knowing everything, but knowing enough about the world to being like, no way. What does that mean? What? And it was very impressive. And I also liked when you would turn and ask Melvin and I questions, and both of us were like, wait, so what does this mean? And we're like, I don't know. You're like, well, so wait, when did this happen? I'm like, I don't know.
You're like a super fan. I love it.
Yeah, no, now. Well, because first season, we spent so much time talking about the universe that I'm an expert now.
You are.
And so it's actually a real fun time.
And you don't have to watch yourself.
Yes, that takes a lot of pressure off.
Yeah.
Well, today we're going to be, speaking of pressure, giving you some very pressure-filled questions that we're going to have to give advice on. Are you ready?
I'm so excited, but I'm also nervous. I don't want to mess up any kids' lives, but...
Hey, don't blame me.
Yeah, don't blame us.
Don't blame us. Don't blame us.
So how do people get advice from you, Meghan?
People can get advice from me by coming up to me in the street, giving me $500 and a puppy, and then I will give you some advice.
That buys you 30 seconds.
Yes, exactly. Or the more complex route would be calling this podcast and leaving a voicemail at 310-694-0976. Again, 310-694-0976. And if you are an international caller, which, oh my God, our guest today is from Canada.
I am an international guest.
Yeah. Do you guys know she's related to Justin Bieber, Drake, and Shania Twain?
All of them. See the family resemblance.
Yeah. And who's your hot prime minister?
Justin Trudeau.
Also, what is Jennifer Aniston's husband's name?
Justin Theroux.
Okay, thank you, because I mix them up all the fucking time.
Anyway, we should get to the questions.
Yes, we should. I'm so sorry. I get excited.
Cool. So are you guys ready to go? Aislinn, how are you feeling?
So ready.
Good?
I'm revved up. I had some brownies that Meghan baked, so I've got a sugar high. I'm so
delicious.
Good. I'm
ready.
Thanks, guys. I'm trying to suck up to Mott's. It's our anniversary tomorrow.
Oh, congratulations.
I know. Fucking crazy. 2 years.
Whoa. Wow. Woohoo.
I know.
Wow.
Yeah, stuck with me.
Okay. All right, let's get into the first call.
Hi, Meghan. So my last single best friend got a boyfriend recently, about 3 months ago. And since then, I've been taking it really hard. I've spent a lot of time crying over it in fear that I was going to lose her in our time together. But I thought it was just being selfish, so I never brought it up to anyone. Recently, I started opening up to my other best friend, who happens to be her sister, and a few other friends about it. And since then, I've realized that I'm not the only one that feels this way. And there's just been red flag after red flag popping up about this boy. And he's turned out to be pretty manipulative. He's very selfish with her time. He barely lets her hang out with her friends. And he gets mad at her when she's not at his house in a timely manner. And he never travels to her house, which is weird. He made her cancel breakfast lunches that were with a very close friend and that's something that she's been doing for years, because he didn't like another man taking her on quote unquote dates. I just don't like the way he's treating her. She's 21 and this is her very first relationship, so I don't think that she knows how to tell him no, and I understand that he'll be okay if she wants to do her own thing and she can still be a good girlfriend if she does that. I hate confrontation, so I haven't brought anything up to her yet because I don't know how. So basically my question is, how do I go about telling my best friend that I basically hate her boyfriend without making her super upset with me?
It's a hard place to be.
It is. Aislinn and I have been staring at each other across the table during this because we definitely have experience with this.
Yeah, so many times, especially I think in young relationships, you end up meeting like your friends' boyfriends and thinking, wow, if we're so close, how can you like someone who is so awful?
Mm-hmm. And I've had that. I've had ex-boyfriends where friends have told me that they really don't like them. And it's created a wedge between that friend and I. And like, I'm definitely, I mean, I think you're also like when you're in like the heat of the, not even the heat of the relationship, when you're in like, you're in it and you're so invested, especially if it's, oh, it's the first relationship I've had. This is like the male attention, all this stuff. Like, I really like this kind of a thing, that you're kind of quick to side with them. And I've definitely sided with like crazy, terrible exes that I've had. And then realized later on when we break up, I'm like, oh, my friends were definitely right. But
That's the hard part, is being the friend who doesn't want to be the I told you so person. Mm-hmm. And you also have that fear if you speak up to that friend and mention how the behavior looks to you, that because they're so blind to it, it's going to drive a wedge between you. And then you're just going to be farther apart from your friend than you even were before. And it's difficult. Now I'm just telling you, like, yeah, get your position. It sucks. Okay, moving on.
Also, even if you, and then if they stay together, there's the whole, I know that you hate my boyfriend. And then if they break up or they want to break up, there's the whole, well, I don't want you to be right. Like, I want to be right in this situation. I don't want this to be as bad as it is that you're saying. I would say, as somebody who's done this, I've been you, and I've been the friend who's told a friend, and I've been there and I've had people do it to me. I don't think it's worth it to have a sit down conversation. I think if you can like gently bring things up in context as it's happening, like if your friend like will not, what are you laughing at?
Just like subtly undermining.
No, but like, I mean, like, I think if like you're, if your friend, if like he says something, if your friend's like, oh, like I can't go to brunch because he doesn't want me to go because he doesn't want another guy taking me out. You're like, well, that seems a little odd because like, it's not like really a date kind of a thing. Just reinforcing if your friend is suggesting that like, oh, this feels a little off
if
to me.
If she feels weird about it, definitely reinforce those feelings.
Yeah, but I don't say plant those.
More conflict.
Exactly. I think that's what I would say.
Yeah, because ultimately she's got to be the one who figures it out. Like no one else is going to be able to tell her your relationship is screwed up. If she's still in love with that guy, she's not going to want to see it. She's not going to see it. Mm-hmm. She has to do that on her own. So unless like you're worried about her physical or emotional safety, which might be in danger at this point, like if he's being that manipulative and like, and not letting her see anyone, I get having those concerns, but I think it's good that you're talking to other people in her life.
And her sister too.
Yeah. And you're trying to like make sure everyone's aware and you're all looking out for her, and ever if she seems that she's in danger, you can step in. But for now, I think your friendship's more important than, like, because you run the risk of losing her if you speak up now. So trying to just stay on her team and whatever she needs, support her in that. And hopefully at some point they'll break up and in a few years, you guys will sit over cocktails and she'll be like, remember when I dated that asshole? I can't believe I did that. And you'll be like, yeah, who knew?
He was the worst. Yeah. No, I think that's good. I think that is good. On to the next call.
Hi, Meghan. I'm 19. Before I get started, I just want to say that I really appreciate your content. I can tell you're a really genuine person and you care about your viewers and your listeners. And I just really appreciate you for that. I really love listening. The question I have, or rather the issue I have, is something that I think a lot of girls or like women my age deal with. Ever since I was, you know, in middle school and high school age, I had a really hard time keeping friends or keeping a friend group. And I know that's really common for middle school and high school because, you know, you're just friends with the people at your school because they're there and, you know, you may not really be that similar to them or whatever. But I'm now a college student and I'm still finding it hard to find friends that I really get along with and who are similar to me and who care about me, genuine friends, things like that. And I know the easy answer would be, you know, join clubs for interests that I have, you know, meet people with the same things, that like to do the same things that I do, things of that nature. But I'm honestly just really busy and there's not a lot of clubs at my school. It's kind of a small school. And I just find myself making friends based on proximity still, even though I'm in college. Like, I'm friends with people in my building or people in my classes, but none of these friends really stick. Or if they do stick, I just don't feel like we have that much in common or I can really trust them or, you know, they really understand me. So I've been struggling with this for a couple of years now. And I was just wondering what your advice would be to finding genuine friends that really care about you. I mean, I have friends, but none of them really understand me that much.
Well, first of all, you're right. Meghan does care very much.
Oh.
You are correct. But I totally feel for you. I think because of school, you kind of get used to making friends out of proximity, that they're just, they're the people who are in your class or like that you play soccer with or that you can like do your English notes with. So I get that in a change of venue, you're kind of now having to go out of your way to find those people that you really connect with. But I'm thinking, you know, do you feel that they really don't understand you, or are you just like a little nervous to open up because this is a newer friendship and you think sort of right off the bat, like, oh, they don't get me? Like, you know, maybe there's just like, you guys need to like sit down and have a, like some real life chats and maybe like be a little bit vulnerable with each other and you'll see, I don't know. Like, I think I've really learned that friendships take a lot of work. And sometimes like that's, you know, it's a lot of work. It means effort, but like it can be rewarding if you're willing to do it. But of course, if those people are still not, like, if you know for a fact that you just don't get along and you just hang out because it's convenient or you have the same classes, I get that desire to find people that you have more in common with.
So what I would say, I don't think there's necessarily an issue in having friendships based on proximity. I think no matter how old you get, that's true. Like the friends you have are like the people you spend time with are because they're close around you. I have a ton of long distance friendships, but like I also have friends in the city that I'm in, not because it's just convenient, but you kind of meet people because it's convenient and then you become friends with them. And I agree in the sense of what Aislinn's saying with giving them the chance to be those kinds of people. I think there's always going to be people that you meet and like right off the bat, you're like, wow, we're going to be really good friends. And then there's other people where you don't, who they project themselves to be out to you might not be who they like really are all of the time. And that's the same thing with you. Like maybe you guys aren't giving off your true self automatically. And it takes a little while to get to know each other. And so I would say give that time to kind of like foster those friendships. And if that's where you're not getting it, but I also will say, which just seems a little like defeating, I didn't have great friends in college. Like I had really good friends and I made really good friends growing up, like in childhood. And then I went through a period of not having any, aside from those friends that I had growing up, like I had no lasting new friendships from the time that I was like 18 until I was probably, I had like one or two. I think Lily was like the only friend that I made in LA that I stayed friends with. And like, that was a time period where like I probably gained and lost like 5 to 7, like decently good friends. And it now on, like in the time I was like, God, is this me? Like, what does this have to do with me or anything
like
that? It was me. It's all totally me. But it took a while for me to find friends that, I mean, I'll be real. Like some of my best friends were out of convenience because we worked on a show together and then are now we're all friends with each other. But like, that's because we were A, forced to be friends and then realized we still liked each other. So I think that there's nothing wrong with being friends with people because you kind of have to, and not just making the best out of those friendships, but like kind of giving them as much of a chance as you would to people who you might have totally parallel interests with. You might have more interest than you actually think you do right off the bat.
Yeah.
That's what I would say. And especially if you're too busy to like join a club or go do other stuff, you're kind of setting yourself up for failure. If you don't want to have convenient based friends, but you don't have time to have any other friends based on convenience, then either you got to choose do the convenient friends or just don't have friends at all. Which I also think I think it's better to, if you really feel like you're not understood and they're not bringing you happiness, I think it's much better to focus on yourself than to kind of like sacrifice yourself to like just to be social just for the sake of being social.
Nice.
Says the antisocial girl who loves sweatpants.
I think she's so busy because she's like probably working and also in school, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, she's been in school for a while, so presumably she'll be finished soon. So hopefully with that newfound free time, she can actually start doing some things that maybe she didn't have time for.
Yeah.
Like take a dance class or what have you.
I like that idea. So, also, who doesn't have friends based on convenience?
I mean, that's where all your friendships come from. You happen to meet people.
School,
You guys met auditioning, right?
Yeah, we met an audition.
Met on the show. That's where we developed a friendship. Exactly. It's just that but at the same time, I feel like we became closer
when the show
afterwards when we were making the effort to see each other.
Exactly.
Like that's sort of the thing is like you have to test those limits and see like if I put in more effort, if they reciprocate, that's how you build the friendship. So it's seems convenient at first and then you can build it into something more than that.
Like once you move away from your hallmate, are you guys still trying to hang out? Like are you being friends with each other just because you're within the same like square foot distance? Mm-hmm. Or like when you're not together, are you guys thinking about each other and like saying hi and like checking in? I think that's where you can kind of you can kind of see. But yeah, all of my friendships, I mean, my relationship was based on convenience. Swiped moths. Ayo. Okay, on to the next call.
Hi, Meghan. So I have a friend that is very, I think that we have a very toxic friendship, but she doesn't really know it, which clearly there is some toxicity there. But so we knew each other in 10th grade and she kind of had her group of friends and I had my group of friends, but we were acquaintances. We were friends. We were both kind of, you know, we came together because we're both, I don't want to say active feminists, but we do try our best to, you know, educate people on feminism and stuff like that. So we came together with that and we became friends because of that. And then this year, last year actually, in 11th grade, she fell out with the group of friends that she was with and she was alone, you know, and she came and she hung out with me because I was the only acquaintance she knew that actually, that didn't turn their back on her, I guess. And we kind of became a very tight knit group. We welcomed her with open arms. I had no problem with that. And, you know, in the beginning of the year for semester, it was all fine. It was all good. But then I started noticing little things, you know, she's a very aggressive human being, which is fine. I don't mind, but it's just, she likes to dish it out. She's mean to everybody. And I'm fine with being mean to my friends, you know, as jokingly matter, but she's all constantly screaming. She's constantly swearing at us. And she thinks that she's joking. She's being cool, but it's very aggressive and it's very insulting sometimes. And it's very just in your face. And she's always yelling at us. And it gets to a point where I'm just like, oh my God, stop. But then I think in my head, I'm like, if I tell her that, she's going to have nobody to hang out with. And I don't want that. You know, I don't want to leave somebody friendless because it's horrible, but she's just always yelling at us. And she constantly thinks that she's, I don't want to say better than us, but she does. You know, whenever I get higher than her in a test, which, you know, happens, like if I get a pointer, she will be very, I don't want to say jealous, but just, she's not happy for me when I do. But when she gets higher than me, then she expects everyone to be over the moon. She genuinely thinks that she is the greatest human being in the room at all times. And she wants everybody to agree with her views, but we can't. Sorry, she wants everyone to agree with her views, but she can't. She can disagree with ours all the time. But if we disagree with hers, she gets hella mad. She gets triggered. She's always angry. And I just don't like that in a friendship, but But I let it go. I was like, we'll just wait till the end of the year. It'll be fine. But I don't want to leave her alone, but she's also really, it gets exhausting trying to tiptoe around her and try to not make her mad and just cater to her constantly. And I don't know if I should continue this friendship or if I should talk to her about it and just let her know, like, hey, this isn't cool. I'm not enjoying this friendship. It's really hard for me mentally and physically. So I don't know what I should do. So just help me. I don't know what I should do with this friendship.
Whoa. This bitch.
Yeah.
Dude, she's the fucking worst. Good God.
Wow. Such an easy answer to this one.
It is so easy. No, bitch needs to be left alone. Aislinn's like, nicer than me though. So.
No, well, that's what true. I was going to say is that I appreciate how nice you are. You're like such an empathetic person, clearly, caller. but I so appreciate the position you're in because I'd probably do the same thing if I was there.
This is Aislinn.
Like,
this is
like,
Aislinn.
Oh, but she's going to be alone and like she's probably going through a lot on her own. Like, you know, she probably hates herself secretly and that's why she lashes out at other people. But like,
that's not
a good enough reason to deal with someone else being an asshole to you. Mm-hmm. Like, this actually sounds like my best friend from my childhood that she always got into fights with other people, but because I was always such a peacemaker, I never really noticed it with me. So I thought it was other people. And then I slowly started to realize that the actual problem was her and that I was being very accommodating to all of her needs, but not getting any of my needs in the friendship met. And then when I started going elsewhere for those needs, she started telling me that I wasn't around enough and that she didn't, like, I wasn't doing enough for our friendship. And that's when we were no longer friends. And it sucked. But, like, you can only help people so much. And when they're treating you like shit, that's not a good reason to stay around. I mean, but I also, I'm down with your idea to talk to her. If you want to, like, bring it up face to face and say, look, we're not into how you treat us or anyone else in the friend group. Like, I say, do that. If it doesn't go well, then cut your losses. You don't need her.
Yeah, I think also Aislinn is also a very empathetic person. Like, you are very, like, this is...
Gets me into trouble.
This is you in a call, like, 100% thinking about the other person who's an asshole to you, where I'm like, fuck this bitch. I've also been in that French before where you don't... It's like you. It's like that. You put the lobster in the cold water, and you turn the hot, and then you like slowly turn it up to hot. That you don't really realize these terrible things that someone's doing or how they treat other people until you're suddenly like, "Holy shit! How did I get so invested in this? I'm burning alive." So I've been that where exactly what you're saying, where you're so accommodating for everyone else's like little things they like or don't like, and you're walking on eggshells and you're tipping toe rounding everything, but they're not doing any of that for you, and you end up sacrificing so much of your own happiness, what brings you joy and your personality and all these things just to make someone else happy. And I also, this is like the totally like pessimistic asshole part of me that I'm like, you, no matter what someone's going through in their life and what they're doing and what they're dealing with, projecting that onto other people, as much as you want to be understanding and think about it from their point of view and what they're going through, at a certain point, the only thing that is going to happen from that is it's going to put you in a worse place. And it's not like you being like, well, they're going through a really bad time, so I'm just going to suck it up and deal with it. The only thing that's happening there is you're letting somebody, you're justifying somebody else's like psychotic ways and letting them do this stuff and being like, you know what? It's okay. You can act like that because you're going through all these things and I'm going to sacrifice my happiness and my mental stability because of that, like of what you're doing. So instead of us walking away from this of being like, you can deal with your own stuff, I am now going to say that like my mental well-being is less important than like making sure that you are coddled and happy, which that just breeds like a terrible human being who thinks they can treat other people like that. And then it just makes you feel like shit. So it's not, I think not saying something is just hurting her more. I think that's just, you're letting her be kind of a shitty person and thinking that she can get away, continue being a shitty person, and that people in her life should accommodate that. I think you should definitely like say something, because if it's out of left field, I mean, I'll be honest, I think there's a very slim chance that she's going to change her ways. Be like, you know what? You're right. Like,
I don't think it's likely.
I've been lashing out because I feel like this at home, and I'm so glad you said something. Like, I'm going to totally change.
But I'm a whole new woman.
A whole new world. But I think like, if it was me, I would say something just so she also can't use it against you, being like, well, that was out of left field. You didn't even give me any warning.
You're not like ghosting her that you guys are just all making plans without her. Like, exactly. Yeah, I think it's really cool of you to want to say something. Yeah.
But then I think you say, you're like, hey, I just like want to have a sit down with you and talk. And I would not do it with her sister and her other friends. I would just do it as you. Otherwise it feels like you're being like, she would feel like she's being ganged up on. Yeah. And so I think saying it in person, don't write a letter. I think letters are so passive aggressive. Good God. I've had a letter like,
stuck in your locker?
No. Sydney wrote me a letter once and she was mad at me and then read it to me on the phone. And now after, it was like, we got in 2 fights in our entire friendship. And then after that, I go, by the way, never fucking do that again. That was so mean. And she was like, oh yeah, I think you're right. And I was like, yeah, I was fucked up, dude. Because I had this image of my best friend writing a letter about why she was mad at me. And I'm like, that's a terrible idea. Like, I don't want that in my head. But I would say like, sit down with her just one-on-one and just be like, hey, I want to have like just a conversation with you and to talk to you about how I'm feeling. I know that we joke around with each other and like, we'll like make fun of each other in kind of a play way. But honestly, how you've been doing it recently has really made me feel shitty about myself. And I've been feeling pretty down about it. I again, wouldn't bring your other friends into it and say, so
we've
all
been talking about how much we hate you.
Exactly. Don't say that, even though you have. And I called a podcast too to talk about how much I hate you. And the two girls on there also think you're a cunt. Sorry. Are you allowed to say that on my show?
You can say whatever you'd like.
I love the word cunt.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah. Cunty, cunt, 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 cunt. I would be honest. I'd be like, and I really care about you and I really love you. And I know that this past year has been really difficult with you friendship wise. And I always want to be there for you. But right now I feel like I'm really sacrificing a lot of my own happiness because I'm trying to make sure you're really happy. And I don't know if this friendship is what's healthy for us, both of us right now. And, I'm not saying that I don't think we should ever be friends again or anything like that. But I think for me, because I care about you and I hope you care about me, that you're okay if we kind of take some time apart to figure stuff out. And then like, I'm always going to be here for you. But right now I really need to not be so invested because I feel like I'm kind of letting myself slip to like the side.
We spend so much time analyzing like romantic relationships and saying like what happens between partners, like this is okay and this isn't. But I find with a lot of friendships, we all let stuff fester because it's like not as serious.
Yeah, because you don't think of breaking up with a friend, but sometimes you need to do
But
that.
Sometimes you need to have a confrontation and say like this doesn't
work for me.
It helps
the other person. It can help the other person. You can
absolutely.
You can
make your friendship stronger because you're being honest and you're saying like this doesn't work, but I value the friendship, so let's try to fix this.
Let's assume for the sake of argument too that maybe she's maybe it's just a matter of her approach to humor is just too caustic. Maybe she's not actually as terrible as she's being sort of painted in the call.
And also because it's psychology 101. Let's say it's probably because of some sort of self-loathing problem.
It is. It
probably
is. It definitely is. She's feeling insecure and less than.
But let's just assume it's just her humor. I think that's feedback that she might need. And she might need...
She wants to be a stand-up comic. Job with that kind of shit.
I mean, she might need to hear that from you as a friend. Realize there are consequences if she continues.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that she can then
in the future.
Go and change and then be a better friend to you and to others.
Yeah.
Because she realized, oh no, there are consequences for being this kind of mean.
Mm-hmm. And also that mean girl thing doesn't fly. And also, you can also be a feminist and also be a bitch. Like, you can totally believe in equal rights for men and women and then also still kind of be a cunt. So I think that can't cut her any slack. I wish everybody was into, you know, that. But I mean, I don't think that can kind of be like a freebie pass. I'm also really not a believer in people who kind of chalk up to any problems they're having personally and then taking it on other people, because that's just not how you deal with your problems. So you can't use this as an excuse, because you're going to have problems your entire life, like childhood and adulthood. And there is no time at any point that people should be justifying how you're behaving, because it's throwing a temper tantrum. It's like you're lashing out at other people because you're hurting, and that doesn't help you or them.
At the same time, with that kind of thing, I always tell my close friends that I cut them slack anytime that something is going on in their lives. And like, if they're short with me or something comes up, like, I'm like, I totally get it, because our friendship is normally at a healthy place.
Exactly.
If something happens and like you momentarily lash out at me, I know why, and I am not going to get mad
norm.
At you. And this also is not the time for me to address it and say, you treated me bad, because I know you're going through a lot of shit. But if that's just your normal, if that's just like the level and the way that they treat you all the time, I know so many people going through such bad stuff, and they always have time for their friends, and they always treat them well. Mm-hmm. And I just don't think that that's a good enough excuse.
I don't think it
so,
is either.
Yeah, I think, talk to her, straighten it out. If you guys can't save the friendship, I think you're going to be fine without her.
Okay, guys, we got to take a quick break, but we'll be right back. Thank you so much to RX Bar for supporting Don't Blame Me. RX Bar is a whole food protein bar made with 100%, yeah, you heard it here, 100% whole ingredients and no BS, such as no added sugar, artificial colors, artificial flavors, preservatives, or fillers. They're made with 100%, that's 100% whole ingredients for all of you who aren't cool in the street slang. RX Bars are made with a few simple, clean ingredients where every ingredient serves a purpose. I love that. I hate things that don't serve purpose. I don't like knickknacks. I don't like fillers in my food. For example, egg whites are a main source of its protein that is easy for your body to absorb. Ugh, love eggs. They're also gluten-free, soy-free, and dairy-free, which is perfect for your homegirl. So thank you so much, RX Bar. There's no added sugar, no artificial colors, flavors, preservatives, fillers, none of it. They also come in 11 amazing, delicious flavor varieties. You got savory, you got chocolate, fruity, there's cacao things, there's real fruit, and there's sea salt in them, which I personally am a huge fan of sweet things with sea salt, because I think it makes everything better. And I am a huge fan of that. So kudos to you, RX Bar, for being up on the foodie game trend. Was that even correct English? Maybe. RX Bars are ideal for breakfast on the go, a snack at the office, or if you don't have an office job, just a snack when you're walking around not having a job. Throw it in your bag for the airplanes that you go on, because you're a traveling jet-setting kind of gal or guy. You can put it in your backpack if you're going on a bike ride or a hike, or you're just walking to the grocery store to buy more food. You can eat it before your workout, after your workout, or if you don't even want to work out and you're like, I just want to eat this RX Bar. You can do that. The world is your oyster, or the world is your RX Bar. Ha ha. That was good. I'm a huge fan of RX bars, as you might all know. I have a grocery list of food allergies of things that I cannot eat at the grocery store. And RX bars actually don't have anything that I'm allergic to, which is incredible and amazing. They're really easy, super convenient. I can throw them in my bag, bring them to set with me if I'm working, or if I'm not working, I can just eat 3 bars in a day and no one knows because I've hidden them so my boyfriend can eat them all. Delicious flavors. There's peanut buttery ones. There's chocolatey, sea salty ones. There's fruity ones. And it's great because we can divide and conquer because he likes the fruity ones and I prefer the salty ones because I love me some salt. If you guys want to get 25% off your first order at rxbar.com/blame, you can do it by using the promo code blame. Again, that's rxbar.com/blame, promo code blame. Woo woo woo. The woo woo woo, you don't have to write it out, just like say it in your head when you type in blame. Type in blame, then in your head go woo. Hey, we're back. Did you miss us? Well, I hope so, because you're still here and we're still here. On to the next call.
Hey, Meghan. I'm 20 and I'm a college student. And I'm going to keep this as short as I can. So I have this friend that's younger than me. He went to the beach for like 4 weeks with this group of guys. And when he came back, he was like FaceTiming, texting this guy all the time. And he's kind of like a more feminine guy. And all of a sudden, he, like, repeatedly comes to me, like, sobbing, like, cannot control, like, his emotion. And long story short, I have reason to believe that there's something going on between him and this guy. And I've indirectly heard that he's admitted that he's gay to one of our other friends. And I don't want to act like a fake friend and not acknowledge it and not like and pretend to not know what's going on, but I also don't want to put him on the spot because I know this is like his journey. So my question is kind of like, have you had a friend that's gay that hasn't come to you about it like directly? Because he comes crying to me but then won't say anything about it, so I don't really know how to deal with it. I love him, he's so sweet, and I just want him the best for him and don't really know what to do. So please help me.
Not your journey. Not your journey. Yeah. Thanks for loving my podcast, but it's not your journey.
Hashtag not your journey.
Hashtag not your journey. Yeah. I mean, it's just that's yeah. kind of.
Because it could be a number of things. It could be that he's not ready to come out to you, or he's mm-hmm. not ready to come out in general and just like is still thinking maybe I'm gay, maybe I'm bi, maybe like I'm pansexual, I don't yeah. know. And then also maybe he also just thinks you already know, I don't know, you know, like it's I had one of my best friends growing up, just like I think we always knew that she was gay, but it took her a while to figure it out. But it's not like we were gonna tell her like mm-hmm. hey,
you're super gay, you have posters
of women all over your bedroom, you're probably gay. But you know, we were letting her go on her journey and tell us when she wanted to.
Yeah.
I think there's totally a way to do it without being weird.
No.
I think there is.
No.
I think you say, honey, why are you upset? Are you having relationship issues? And then you say, what's their name? And then that's his opportunity if he chooses to. And if he chooses not to, then you back the fuck off.
Yeah. I think it also depends on what he's coming to her for. If he wants advice
It sounds like he is, because he's coming to her sobbing is what she said.
But there's sometimes you just want to come cry to a friend and you don't want to talk about what it's about. And yeah, you can just be a warm body for a hug.
And I think you can also offer that as well. I think give them the opportunity, because I think sometimes people might want the opportunity to know, like, this is a safe space. You can talk to me about mm-hmm. what's going on.
You don't want
to
feel like you're blindsiding.
Yeah, but also without saying directly, you know, who is, are you or aren't you? Because that's irrelevant. The fact is, if you're having a relationship issue, you could be having a friendship relationship issue. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's just like, tell me who hurt you, basically.
Exactly.
And then let that person then fill in all the blanks. I agree. It's, you can't out somebody, especially she says she's 20 and her friend is younger. So, I mean, sometimes people don't feel comfortable coming out until they're in their 20s. That's very common.
I had a good friend in college who I knew he was gay. I always knew, but never said anything, never brought it up.
It's also irrelevant.
Exactly. That's one of the things. I'm like, this is not relevant for our friendship at all. Yeah. And he told me when we were in college that he liked me and he had a crush on me. And I remember my response, I was like, I think we're really good friends.
and I love you so much as a friend. And I think you love me a lot as a friend too. But I don't think that I honestly, and I was like, I'm flattered that you would say that, but I don't think that you're into me like that. I was like, I really don't think you are. And he's like, no, I'm pretty sure I am. And in that moment, I could be like, no, homeboy, you're fucking gay. But I, instead, I'm like, you know what? Like, I love you. And I think that's really sweet. And that makes me happy. I hope we can stay friends. But I don't think, I don't really see you like that.
Yeah, you also don't want to be wrong.
Oh, no, my God. Can you imagine? My God. No, but I also, like, I wonder if he's even listening to this. I have one of my very, very best guy friends from, like, childhood growing up has never identified his sexuality once. Ever. We have been best friends since we were 10 years old. Not once ever have me or any of my other friends been like, hey, what gender or what like non-conforming gender do you identify with or are you into? Literally have never once asked. It's never come up. And that changed nothing in our friendship. Like, I would not ever say that like we're not closer because he hasn't said or admitted what he is or is not into sexually.
I identify following ways.
Exactly. And it changes nothing about a friendship. And I get that it's hard to see someone so upset, but why does it matter if he's upset over a boy or if he's upset over a girl? He'll be upset over like and heartbroken over anything.
Yeah.
I think your advice that you're going to give a friend who's heartbroken has no gender. It really won't change based on the sexual orientation of who he's having a relationship with. I totally understand. Also, if he's told another friend of yours that he has come out to another friend of yours, you might feel slighted and feel like, wow, why did this person get to know? And like you feel closer to them than
me. You don't want to tell me. Yeah.
Yeah. But it's not about you. And maybe there was a situation where that person, it just came up naturally. But I do agree with like teeing it up in a sense of being like, I'm going to give you an opportunity to say this so you don't have to feel like you're pulling that out of the blue and just like spewing it out. I'm going to give you an opportunity to say it if you need that sort of like training wheel support, and you can take it or you cannot. And then I think if he doesn't take it, I say just drop it and just be like a good ear and like a shoulder to cry on. And then eventually he will or will not come out. And I don't think it matters if he does or doesn't, because it won't change your friendship. Him coming out to you is not going to prevent him from feeling like he is having an identity crisis and accepting his sexuality. Like that process of accepting it doesn't end with coming out to his friends. It's dealing with coming out to his family. It's dealing with like the social constructs around being gay and all of this other stuff that doesn't, just because you're going to be accepting doesn't mean every other step is going to be easier. So I think it's like you can't avoid, he has to go through that journey and he can't avoid it. And I guarantee you at this point, from even just your call, you sound like you're super supportive of it. And he knows that you're super supportive. I don't think you need to be explicit in saying it.
But you can say like just generally like, hey, you know, I love you. Yeah. And if you want to talk, I'm always here. And if you don't want to talk, I'm also here. Like we can hang out and talk about anything, or we can talk about what's bothering you. Like just.
Yeah. Exactly. I'm here for you no matter what it
is. Yeah, exactly.
And then you're not being another, because I'm sure he's probably getting pestered by all these other sides. And if you can be that person who's like, God, I know that I can go hang out with her and I know she's not going to ask me about it or question me about it, and I can just be myself. You're not another hurdle he has to jump over. Yeah. So it's also no offense, you're probably not the one he's like struggling to tell. I think if he's like having a hard time coming to terms with it, it's probably telling people who aren't going to be as supportive. And you're probably one where he was like, well, I know she'll be easy with this. It'll be great. And that kind of a thing. So I don't necessarily think that he needs to be super explicit with you of his sexuality in order to know that you support him. I think you can support him without, like he's been saying, with just saying like, I love you unconditionally. And your support doesn't have to be in the whole, like, by the way, I know you're gay and I like that.
Yeah.
Like,
and for his sexuality to not have to be his whole, like, waking life, that's the only thing he's thinking about or talking about with his friends. If he can have like a break from like thinking about this really tough time in his life, you know, like it's hard to make that to be coming out, because also a friend of mine explained like coming out is not just like a one-time deal. Like it's something that you have to then do for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. And that I think is a really tough door to open and say like, okay, this is just going to be forever. This is going to be my daily life now. So if he's taking his time and figuring it out, I think you can just be there for him as a friend.
Well, you're not going to believe this, but we have come to the end of the podcast.
Mm-hmm. Already?
Wow.
Yeah, we've been recording for this long now.
Shut the front
Oh my God,
out.
We can talk we too much. Can't.
No, this is what Ace was nervous before this. And I was like, Ace, I made her, Mots was out of town for like a week and I made her stay over and literally sleep over for a week straight. And all we did was talk.
Yep.
So well, you're very good at it. We have time for one more call.
Just Ooh. One more.
Which, yeah. So I've, this is the part of the show.
It's Producer's Corner.
That's
Producer's
right.
Corner.
Yes.
Can you explain what Producer's Corner is?
I can't, but Aislinn also knows, but I explained
because I'm a super fan, but it's okay. Explain it to me in person.
Explain it. Producer's Corner is when producer director Jack Ferry, he picks his favorite call, most memorable call, a call that he wants us to focus our attention on. Mm-hmm. It's usually pretty groundbreaking.
Yeah.
Pretty
to
impactful.
Give like the extra good advice. Like we've reserved yeah. the really, really good advice mm-hmm. for right now.
Okay. I've saved my turbo engine.
Yeah. I feel like this one's very appropriate for like the themes of today's episode. Cool. So let's hit it.
It's about girls and vaginas.
Do it.
Feminism.
Hi, Meghan. I've got a question for you that I think you'd be perfect to answer for me. So where do I begin here? All right. So for a while now, my favorite, well, you know what? I would rather than say names, I'll just say my favorite team has been having issues with getting hits while there's runners in scoring position.
Oh, good.
And,
God.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, now
really
it's
tough.
Postseason, and, you know, they're up against some of the best pitching in the league. And, you know, they just can't seem to produce when, you know, they've got runners on. And, you know, it's problematic. Like, you can't win games if you can't score runs, you know?
That
so
is baseball.
What advice would you give to these players that are just getting in their heads and not seem to be able to produce when the spotlight's on them, the big moment? You know, we're trying to get to the World Series here. Any advice you have would be great. Thanks.
Wow.
I would say go Giants.
That's a baseball team.
It is. Well, that's my baseball team.
Nice.
Yeah.
I think based on all of that, the detail in that one, I'm going to take a wild guess and say it's the Yankees.
Hey.
I'm cheating because Jack's wearing that hat and he was watching the game
it's
earlier.
Okay. Leo thought it was the Mets.
He did think it was the Mets. Hey, yeah. he got the city right.
He did.
Oh, wow. So it says NY on your hat. That.
You know.
Sure. It's pretty easy.
But yeah, to all the New York Yankee players out there
who are listening
to this podcast.
Yeah.
Guys, keep your head up.
Thank you. Yeah.
Pay attention.
Look within.
Look alive.
Look within.
You know, go Wildcats.
Go Wildcats in the
house. All in this together.
Get your head in the game.
Yeah. That's the key one. Get your head in the game.
I knew you guys would be able to solve this.
I know,
I'm so glad that I picked this call for this episode.
I am too. Yeah, we should be like sports psychologists.
We should. Do those exist?
Oh, yeah. They actually, they do have people that come and like help
do
people.
Do not help the
players because
that's Mots' dream.
I find it so crazy like how much.
Being a sports psychologist? Okay. He says no, never mind.
He's very meh about that
but
idea.
But like sports players can get really, really superstitious about playing. And I find that so funny.
As Jack wears a baseball cap for the first time I've ever seen him wear a baseball hat.
I always wear a baseball hat during the playoffs.
Well, no, that's what I'm saying. You're being superstitious. I've never seen you wear it aside from
Well, actually, it's more in the spirit. You know, it's the same way that you would wear like a
cheerleading uniform.
You would like how you would wear a Christmas sweater at a Christmas party.
Oh, Jack knows my brand.
Just
Hell
saying,
yeah.
I would. I, I'm
festive.
Being in the spirit. Yeah, I'm being in the spirit of the season. It's the postseason, so I'm wearing a baseball hat. But anyway, but seriously, if you can't score runs, you're not going to win games. So, any advice you have for these players?
Wait,
Meghan,
so what are they not doing?
You know, they get men on and then they can't hit them home. So, it's like a
this
problem.
All, for the record, no matter what, this just sounds so sexual. They get men on and they can't hit it home. They can't hit it home.
Well, it's
you
funny
can't score if you're not playing.
Well, it is funny because it's like there's the bases.
Bases,
first base, second
base,
third base.
What do you think the
bases
are?
Surprisingly sexual.
What do you think the bases are?
Haven't we had, we've talked about this
I know,
before. We've had a debate.
We've talked about everything. So let's just talk about it on the air.
Well, I guess first base is kissing, making out, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Second base is chest area,
chesticles?
Under the shirt,
whatever. God, the
anything
shirt.
Above the belt. And then third
it's,
base,
it's,
I've just always assumed is like having sex. I don't know.
What?
No, it's the four.
Where do blowjobs go?
It's the four Fs.
Okay, well,
we talked about this with Mel.
I guess,
Mel, chime in again on this mic here.
Mel?
I've never heard anyone refer
bases.
To, like, having sex as, like, I hit a
home run
last night. Like,
I mean, 16-year-olds. Okay, Mel, got
All
it.
Right. Yes, Mel. French, fill, finger, fuck.
French,
and I learned a new
feel.
One, too.
The dugout.
Felatio?
The dugout.
Is that ass work?
Yeah.
That's some ass work. That's some booty play.
See,
We
somehow managed to take this stupid sports question and turn it into sex anyway.
That's Meghan's brand.
It is my brand. Well, this was such a fun episode. Aislinn Paul, where can people find you?
Ooh, you can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Aislinn Paul at both of them because my name was not taken.
Good job.
I know, with your name. Having an unusual name. Yeah, thanks, parents. Thanks, Mom and Dad.
You got great parents, too. Shout out to your parents.
Yeah,
they're not
shout
listening.
Out to Deborah and Brian. They probably will listen.
Awesome. I love them. If you guys enjoyed this episode, we would love if you I'm going to speak English one day. First, I'm going to tell all of you, if you liked this episode, leave a review on the Apple Podcast app. We would love it. Rate 5 stars like my aggressive Uber who would not let me leave the car until I did it. He was the worst. He also offered to turn off the Uber like ride thing.
No, always say no.
I know because he was like, hey, you're picking your friend up. Well, like, why don't like she just hop in here and then I'll take you there. And I was like, oh, I don't think she's ready yet. He's like, well, I'll turn off the ride thing. And so you don't have to pay. And I'm like, so I can get in your car and it's going to say you drop me off here. And then I'm in your unmarked vehicle for this whole time. And I'm not accounted for. I'm not stupid, sir.
No, all right, so leave us 5 stars.
Okay. Yes, leave us 5 stars. More of the story. And then if you guys want to leave us a voicemail, if you need our advice, or if you are a caller from a previous episode or this episode, and you want to give us a update on your life, we would love to hear. So you can call us at 310-694-0976. Again, that is 310-694-0976. We would love to hear from you. We would love to hear about your life and the things that are happening and what you need help. And if you're an international caller, because international people have problems too, just because you don't have Trump doesn't mean your life doesn't suck sometimes. Oh, that's a good tagline.
Yeah.
That's a very long one. You guys can send a voice memo by recording it on your phone and then just emailing it to meghanpodcast@gmail.com. Okay, guys. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Go follow Aislinn. Go follow me. Go follow Jack Ferry. Go follow everybody. Just only if they ask for it. Consensual following.
Consensual following.
Consensual following. Okay. We will see you in 2 weeks. Goodbye.
Don't Blame Me is a production by me, produced and directed by Jack Ferry, associate producer Melissa DeMonts, edited by Melissa DeMonts, post-production sound by Chris Henry, and music by Giacomo Picasso and Ryan Hunter. I will see you guys in 2 weeks, and don't blame me if your life bursts into flames before then.